June is also the month that the country celebrates pride in support of the LGBTQ community. And while representation for people of color and LGBTQ Americans has grown in mainstream culture, it still lags behind for people who are members of both communities. NewsHour Weekend's Yvette Feliciano spoke with an author who is trying to change that.
Growing up gay and black in the 1990s, photographer and documentarian Jamal Jordan says he never saw himself represented in popular media, even as LGBTQ people gained greater visibility in U.S. culture.
It really felt that that was just a white queer moment that I just could not be a part of, right?
Decades later, those long-held feelings drove him to write a series for the New York Times, Queer Love in Color, which he has expanded into a book. In it, Jordan documents the stories of queer couples of color from all over the U.S., Canada, and South Africa.
How did you eventually choose all of the couples that are featured in the project?
I made a list of about 20 cities that I wanted to visit. I started in my hometown of Mobile, Alabama. It was really important for me to start in my hometown, I think, because I want every queer child to know that the love they want is possible wherever they are. And so it was really healing for me to be able to go home and say, like, this community existed and always had existed. And the thing that I thought would never be possible was always just in my backyard, right?
The experience of queer people of color is often so associated with struggle.
Yeah.
And there's such a wide range of experiences in your book, specifically with Mike and Phil in Detroit. Why did you decide to feature them?
When you're trying to build your identity around, like, the stories that are told around you, like, it hurts when the only thing you see is pain and trauma at the expense of telling the stories of happiness, love, joy, and, like, flourishing that were, like, there but just uncovered. Mike and Phil spoke a lot about how important, like, their elders were in the time, and how being coming of age in Detroit in 1967, 68, having older queer people to look up to was such an important thing for them. So, like, they've, like, made a big part of their life mission to be that same place for other people. There's something so psychologically profound about being able to be a kid and see, say, like, look up to some older person and know that that's a possibility model for yourself.
What was it like to document queer family life? And what was your relationship to LGBTQ families before this project?
All the kids that I met, they had, like, really fascinating things to say about love and, like, seeing their parents have to navigate the larger structures that make it difficult for queer parents to, like, raise children, and, like, how much of a reflection of love that was for them. Mm. So
they're perceiving that even at
even as a young age, because you know, kids are a lot smarter than we give them credit for. There's one couple, El Farouk and Troy. They said one thing so succinctly that I think a lot of the parents that I met felt, and it was that they did a lot of work to build a family for themselves, but now they're doing other work to make the world better for the child that they've brought into it.
Are there any stories or couples that stick with you on a daily basis?
I always go back to the story of Amisha and Nina. They met as friends in 2001, and they had a 14-year back and forth of being deeply in love with each other, but not really confessing it to each other. Eventually, they have this, like, really beautiful moment after 14 years where they have this phone call at 3 in the morning in which they meet after and cuddle for an hour and then, you know, plan the rest of their life together. I think about it a lot because I think so much of the pain of not being able to see, like, images of love that reflect you is that you kind of lose out on the, like, serendipity and magic of, like, love and meeting people and connections. It gave me a new, like, goal, hoping that, like, as we normalize more images of queer people of color, we let queer people feel that magic, the serendipity of love too, and approach it more with happiness and openness instead of fear.
How important is visibility, the visibility of queer love?
I don't think that I'm overstating it in saying that, like, for a lot of people, particularly younger people, it can really be a matter of, like, life or death, you know? In tying the stories in the book together, I learned how common it was for the people in it to feel that they'd grown up and never heard a positive thing about, like, being a queer person of color, or actively had people tell them that, like, they had less value, their love would be impossible. And I think that there's such a radicalizing power of being able to say, like, so look, there are people like you. They exist all over the world.